Recently, Equatorial Guinea moved its capital from Malabo, a city that is located on an island off that country's mainland territory, to a purpose-built city on the mainland. This new city or capital is called Jiblo or Oyala, depending on what you happen to be reading at that particular time. Now, I guess they'll figure out what name to stick with once they have finished all the construction, swept away all the debris, and the ordinary folks have started moving in and settled the place. However, this video is not about Equatorial Guinea or its new capital. Although, it is while I was watching videos on YouTube of the new capital with its splash hotels and buildings and grand designs that I started thinking about something that has been on my mind for some years now. And this is, what if Uganda were ever to move its capital? What would the ideal site for this capital city be? I've been thinking about this for a while now, and the more and more I think about it, the more I'm beginning to think that the small district of Amolatar in northern Uganda might just be this ideal site. Why Amolatar, you might ask? Well, I have my reasons, but I'll get to those in a short while. However, first, let's get some background to all this. The idea of building a new capital has been around for decades, but it has remained just that, an idea. Over the last few years, Kampala has become more and more congested and has practically run out of room to expand. Besides, any attempts at widening the roads or creating any major infrastructure are fraught with all manner of headaches. This is largely because when Kampala was first conceived and planned as a modern city in the early 1900s, it was meant to cater primarily for a ruling white elite and an Asian business class. Therefore, the parts of the city where these two classes of people lived were well planned with paved roads, good drainage, functioning sewer systems and all that. The rest of the city was given just the most basic amenities. At independence in 1962, Kampala's infrastructure and public amenities were suited for a population of about 100,000 people. The immediate post-independence government went somewhere in creating and implementing a structural plan that was intended to address the needs of the majority of the city's people. However, most of these plans were abandoned in the years of political instability throughout the 70s and the 80s, and even that which was working at independence fell into disrepair and a lot of the public infrastructure crumbled. Anyway, fast forward through all that, and right now the permanent population of Kampala is around 1.8 million, while the daytime population, including the metro population, can be as high as 5 million. Yet the infrastructure, road, sewage system, etc. has changed little from the 1960s. As the population increased and the demands to plan for a city that is both the commercial, industrial and administrative hub of the country grew, some people started toying around with the idea of building a new capital. This idea has been popular in some circles, but no moves have ever been made to seriously discuss it and see how feasible it is. In 2015, Parliament gave its approval for the creation of a new capital, citing all the reasons I've given and a few more. This news created some buzz for a while, but it soon died down. However, like I mentioned, the idea of a new capital comes up every now and then, but there never seems to be any consensus on where this city ought to be. But for some time now, the preferred site has been Nakasongola, the northernmost district of Uganda or the central region. Nakasongola has its pros, like being sparsely populated, hence having a lot of land for construction and future expansion of the capital. It is more centrally located than Kampala is. The place is generally flat, which is always a good thing when building planned cities. Nakasongola also borders Lake Choga, which would provide a much-needed source of water for the city. Also, Nakasongola is close to Kiriandongo, which is the site of the Karuma Dam, which will be the biggest hydropower dam in Uganda when it's completed in a few years. So electricity will not be an issue for this new capital city. However, despite all of Nakasongola's advantages, I personally feel that Amolatar district would be technically the better location for any new capital. And you might ask why. First of all, Amolatar is only separated by Nakasongola district by around 8 kilometers of Lake Choga at, you know, the narrowest crossing point, which means that in terms of location, it enjoys almost all the advantages that Nakasongola has.
In fact, I believe it's the most central site, being roughly equidistant east, west, north and south from Uganda's borders. The topography is also mostly flat, making it equally ideal for large-scale construction. The district is surrounded by water on three sides, by Lake Kwania to the west, Lake Choga to the south and east. This means it has more water than Nakasongola, and it also receives more rainfall on average than Nakasongola, which is largely dry. Now, the fact that Amolatar is surrounded by water on three sides can be viewed as a disadvantage, in that it makes it slightly harder to access from Kampala and other southern areas. However, I think this is not such a big issue, and it can be easily overcome with some clever road linkages. Also, being surrounded by water on three sides creates a chance to build a bridge that connects the northern and southern halves of Uganda. This bridge could run from Zengebe in Nakasongola to Namasale in Amolatar. This is an ideal crossing point, and in fact there's already a ferry plying this route. This bridge will be costly, I know, but I believe that it would pay for itself in a short while when the capital is established and settled. Besides, it would be an ideal chance to have a grand infrastructure project that will in itself be a major landmark or iconic structure, a Ugandan equivalent of the Golden Gate Bridge
or Lagos's third mainland bridge.
Besides, Lake Choga is a shallow lake, so I'm guessing it might not actually be that much of an engineering feat to build a long bridge across it.
I could go on and on trying to give justifications for why I think Amolatar would make a good site for any future capital of Uganda, but the technical reasons are not really why it appeals to me more. The reasons that appeal to me more are those of a more political nature.
Having the administrative capital in northern Uganda would be a big boost towards developing the region and going some distance in correcting the historical concentration of development projects and economic activities in the quote-unquote Bantu areas south of Lake Choga. The greater northern region has suffered decades of neglect to varying degrees since colonial times, and this has been compounded by a two-decade-long civil war that meant the region remained stagnant while most of the country was slowly moving forward. Therefore, having a city in the region will most certainly stimulate development and provision of services for the people of the area, and in the process create some kind of north-south equilibrium. I also believe that on some level, a capital city in northern Uganda will help draw the people of the north and south closer and go some way in fostering national unity. Not least because of the interactions and the inevitable migration to the city, but also because things that happen around the capital or centers of power like parliament tend to attract nationwide attention. Besides, if the capital were to be built in Nakasongola, this would not only mean that the two most important cities in the country were in the south, but it would also mean having both these cities in Buganda. And knowing my Ugandan people's obsession with regional balance, this might not go down too well. Furthermore, on the same day that Parliament approved the creation of a new capital, it also approved the creation of four regional cities, including Arua, Gulu, Mbale, and Mbarara, and it also designated five strategic cities, which included Hoima as a center for the oil and gas sector, Fort Poto as a tourism city, Moroto as a city for mining development, and Nakasongola and Jinja as industrial cities. This means Nakasongola will still be developed as an industrial city, and having the administrative capital just across Lake Choga could raise the potential for so many positive linkages that I cannot begin to enumerate here. And also, that bridge we talked about earlier just got a little more necessary. From my point of view, there's more to gain for the country if quiet, sleepy Amolatar was made the future of the country. Leaving Kampala to concentrate on growing its profile as a true heartbeat and engine of growth for Uganda by developing it as a hub of finance, transport, education, entertainment, so on and so forth, and this can only be advantageous. Now, granted, a lot of what I've just said is plain theorizing and hypothesizing with very little in the way of concrete examples on how these ideas can be put into action.
After all, I'm not an urban planner, neither am I a civil engineer, so there might be all sorts of reasons why Amolatar just can't work. And also, some other people say that there's no need to have a second or to build a new capital to replace Kampala, because all the problems that Kampala is having now are better dealt with, or can be better dealt with, by developing other urban centers that will take the pressure off the capital city, thus leaving it free to grow and prosper. And that's a valid point. But should the move ever be taken or given real consideration to have the capital city of Uganda moved away from Kampala, I believe Amolatar is a site worth considering. Let me know what you think in the comments, and thanks for watching. Bye.